Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Let us pray. Merciful God, who sent your messengers, the prophets, to preach repentance and prepare the way for our salvation, give us grace to heed their warnings and forsake our sins, that we may greet with joy the coming of Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. A shoot shall come out from the stump of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eye sees or decide by what his ears hear, but with righteousness he shall judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt around his waist, and faithfulness the belt around his loins. The wolf shall live with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the kid, the calf and the lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze, their young shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the asp,
and the weaned child shall put its hand on the adder's den. They will not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain. For the earth will be full of knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. On that day, the root of Jesse shall stand as a signal to the peoples. The nations shall inquire of him, and his dwelling shall be glorious. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. Whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, so that by steadfastness and by the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. May the God of steadfastness and encouragement grant you to live in harmony with one another, in accordance with Christ Jesus, so that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome one another, therefore, just as Christ has welcomed you, for the glory of God. For I tell you that Christ has become a servant of the circumcised on behalf of the truth of God, in order that he might confirm the promises given to the patriarchs, and in order that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. As it is written, therefore I will confess you among the Gentiles and sing praises to your name. And again he says, rejoice, O Gentiles, with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all your Gentiles, and let all the peoples praise him. And again Isaiah says, The root of Jesse shall come, the one who rises to rule the Gentiles. In him the Gentiles shall hope. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
In those days, John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness of Judea, proclaiming, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." This is the one of whom the prophet Isaiah spoke when he said, "The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." Now John wore clothing of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Then the people of Jerusalem and all Judea were going out to him and all the region along the Jordan, and they were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. But when he saw many Pharisees and Sadducees coming for baptism, he said to them, "You brood of vipers,
Who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruit worthy of repentance. Do not presume to say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our ancestor. For I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children to Abraham. Even now the axe is lying at the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance, but one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor and will gather his wheat into the granary. But the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, please be seated. John the Baptist, the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, proclaims, "The kingdom of heaven has come near." 8 years ago, I was headed home early from a sabbatical. In the late afternoon the previous day, I had received a call from my dad telling me that my mom was dying and that if possible, I might want to head back home. I was in Idaho when I received the call. It was a long drive between Idaho and Orlando. Altering my route for expediency would take me across a mountain pass, shortcut, which would take me to Jackson Hole, Wyoming. The vehicles headed from the pass and toward me were covered in snow, which is exactly what I had hoped to see. I took the turn and headed up across the pass. About halfway up the mountain, I realized that I had made a serious mistake. I had bitten off more than I could chew. I was in way over my head when it came to navigating an icy mountain pass. By the time I was two-thirds of the way up, I knew I was in trouble. More trouble than I had ever been in while driving a car. I was scared, really scared. I could not recall being that scared and have not been that scared since. And I was alone. I was also a little angry at myself. I made it up over the pass, realizing then that the drive back down the other side was even more frightening than the drive up. Never again. Driving the rest of the day until nightfall, I made it to a little town in Wyoming called Rock Springs. It had been a harrowing day, and I just wanted to find a place to get some dinner and go to sleep. After asking around, it seemed that the only viable restaurant was an Applebee's, which was packed because it was the only place in town. It was filled with high school kids in tuxedos and gowns because it was prom night in Rock Springs, and this was the only place to go out and eat. It was Americana, but it was not the Americana that I was used to. Getting up early the next morning and heading east on Interstate 80, I knew that I had one stop left to make. It was the last planned stop I had been determined to make long before I had even started my sabbatical. I had driven for about 4 hours. The scenery was absolutely breathtaking. Rolling prairie covered in patches of snow. The golden grassland hid the state's true wealth just under the surface. Coal, and lots of it. Thousands of square miles of coal could be mined by barely scratching the surface of the very grass that fed the roaming cattle. Ranch hands were trading in their horses for drag lines and track hoes and loaders. Hard hats replaced cowboy hats. But for whatever it was worth, I liked the feel of this place. For me, there was the nostalgic romance of frontier towns scattered between weather-damaged roads, void of speed limit signs. Huge wind turbines dotted the golden sea of grassland, silhouetted against a cobalt blue sky. Turning north off I-80, I was about to reach the day's destination, Laramie, Wyoming, home to the state's one and only university, a significant railroad depot, and a town mixed with cowboys and college students. What I was to learn later was that its utter isolation was also a breeding ground for a significant methamphetamine trade and its attending dependency. This was a northern outpost for the real-life characters of Breaking Bad before there was a Breaking Bad. After turning off the interstate, the road narrowed and you could see the university up ahead. The road was empty except for a white Ford F-250 with a front bench seat headed toward me and taking up more room than I really wanted to cede. But he was going to win this argument hands down. I eased my right side wheels onto the gravel shoulder. What I saw approaching was right out of central casting. A plaid-shirted young man with his girlfriend sitting as close to him as possible without pushing him out the driver's side door. He had his left hand on top of the steering wheel and his right arm resting on the top of the seat back, draped around his girlfriend. It was classic Larry McMurtry stuff. I'll never forget my reaction, a mixture of exactly what I expected to see, and yep, that pretty much confirms my expectations. I liked it. There was a part of me that wishes that I was in that truck. But it also made me uneasy because my prejudices were boiling up to the surface. The kingdom of God has come near. I knew where I was and I knew what I had come to see. There was just no way I could have ever passed up the opportunity, knowing I was driving out west, trying to not only take in the rich beauty of our country, but also its hidden underbelly. Curiosity and a desire to gain a better understanding of people pushed me out of my hotel rooms and out on the road for almost a month now. And Laramie was going to be the grad school thesis of my quest to understand who, how, and why throughout much of the country. The telling of this story seems wholly appropriate as we read from the Gospel of Matthew in this liturgical cycle. And we are reminded today of the words of Isaiah when he spoke of the voice crying out in the wilderness, "Prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." Matthew Shepherd was not a very big guy. It's a kid, really. He was only 21, a student at the University of Wyoming, whom friends said maybe on a good day might have weighed 100 pounds. Matthew was born in Casper, Wyoming, about 120 miles north of Laramie. But he had also lived abroad with his family in the Middle East. He had traveled to North Africa and had attended the American school in Switzerland. He had also gotten his butt kicked a couple of times and assaulted in Morocco while on a school field trip. It wouldn't be the only time. Matthew was also an Episcopalian. He had served as an acolyte when he was younger. He attended the Canterbury Club while at the University of Wyoming. Matthew was also gay and apparently fairly brash about not hiding that fact. His family said he simply refused to live a lie. He was, at the time, also HIV positive. Being gay and living in Laramie, Wyoming in the 1990s was more than a challenge. It was deadly. Matthew Shepherd was beaten and killed, crucified, actually, because he was gay. The year was 1998. In the span of time today, it was just 3 years less than Matthew was old. In August of 1998, Anglican bishops from around the world met at the behest of the Archbishop of Canterbury in Lambeth, England, to craft a statement about sexuality. And we, as we have recently witnessed on a recent bus ride video to a movie studio, putting a group of men in a rather isolated environment with the topic of sex being the focus of discussion, it rarely leads to an enlightened discussion or sound decisions. Yet the kingdom of God has come near. The Lambeth Conference on Sexuality in August of 1998, after a vote involving 641 bishops, 526 voting in favor, 70 against, and 45 abstaining, promulgated the following resolution, which in part reads, quote, "Homosexuality was incompatible with Scripture. Marriage could exist only between a man and a woman. Yet all of God's people should be loved and cared for." It was hoped at the time that this would not be seen as a license to hate. It did not work out that way. People died while church leadership fretted over what to do and how they would be perceived by others. Leadership failed to lead the church. Leadership caved to public opinion. And still, the kingdom of God comes near. 2 months later, following that Lambeth conference, Matthew Shepherd, a member of the Anglican flock, an American Episcopalian, would be crucified, beaten and left to die in the cold night air, tied to a buck fence out in a field east of the town in which he lived, begging for his life. His welfare had in part been decided by those vicars of Christ in Lambeth after having taken a vote. How entirely democratic. How gutless and misguided can one get? Doing what is right does not require a vote. And in this case, their vote, in a way, sanctioned discrimination. And still, the voice cries in the wilderness, "The kingdom of God has come near." As I drove around the town that cold afternoon in November of 2009, I found a community that, although small, had several focal points. The University of Wyoming unquestionably loomed large, but so did the rail yard with its spur tracks and its sidings and its buildings and its storage facilities. The quaint town itself was right out of a movie set. There were shops and offices and restaurants and bars and law offices and antique shops. People took their dogs to work and sat in the front windows to warm themselves in the sun on the cold day. The streets were freshly plowed of snow, and art galleries were plentiful. I would call this town my home in a heartbeat. I headed out east of town, looking for the spot where Matthew was left to die that night in early October of 1998. There were no road markers, and the Chamber of Commerce somehow had admitted this spot on its otherwise very welcoming folding map, which was available in every single store. I knew the location was up in an area called Cactus Canyon in the Sherman Hills area, as I recall. There was a college student out riding his mountain bike when I was there. I stopped and I asked him if he knew where the site was located. He looked down at the ground, then pointed up the road. He said to follow the road until it turned sandy. He warned me to watch out for the soft sand under the snow because if I got stuck, I would probably be there for a while. I don't think that he was really thrilled that the guy with the Florida license plates had driven out to see the worst thing that had ever happened in an otherwise very friendly town. I drove for no more than 2 or 3 minutes, and there it was. The site was pretty unmistakable in an otherwise barren hillside. The most distinguishing feature was the buck and rail fence that ran along the side of the hill. These types of fences are incredibly common out west. They help to block the blowing snow and to contain livestock. The fences are made of posts fashioned in an A-frame with rails running laterally through the cross posts. There were flowers. There were letters and candles and mementos everywhere. In hindsight, it reminds me today of the makeshift memorial set up at the Pulse nightclub in Orlando. It was a place of overbearing reverence. It was indeed holy ground. The kingdom of God had indeed come near. A sign was posted explaining what had taken place. It was obviously a place of pilgrimage for many. It had been 10 years, but emotions were still raw. The university had graduated 11 classes since that night of that horrible event. The incoming freshmen that year were only 7 or 8 years old when Matthew was murdered in 1998. Matthew Shepard had been lured into a car somehow and was driven out to the canyon hilltop. Matthew's perpetrators knew he was gay and fully intended to make an example of him. This was a hate crime before there was even a name for it. The date was October 6, 1998. It would be another decade before the United States would consider sexuality when deciding hate crimes. I cannot imagine the fear and loneliness he must have experienced. I wonder if he was angry or whether I am just projecting my own anger. Matthew was tied to the buck fence in a fashion that reflected a crucifixion. Matthew was pistol whipped and beaten about the head and face. The beating was so intense that his skull was fractured and his spine was severed. His attackers said that they had left him begging for his life. Somehow, like Christ before him, he had survived the ordeal up to that point. I firmly believe that Jesus Christ was present when that crucifixion took place in Laramie and clearly understood and experienced the pain all over again. Matthew Shepard was found alive the next day by a gentleman who had mistaken him for a scarecrow tied to a fence. The female police officer who was subsequently dispatched and found him remembers the massive amount of blood that covered almost every part of his body. She herself had become covered in blood as she cut him down and tried to keep him alive. The only part of Matthew's face that was not covered in blood was where his tears ran down from his eyes in such a way that they washed the dried and caked blood from his face in little wiggly streaks. Matthew was soon to enter the kingdom of God. Matthew Shepard, the Episcopal acolyte, was taken to the hospital in Fort Collins, Colorado, where he clung to life in a coma for 6 days. He died on October 12, 1998, from severe head trauma. Matthew was buried at St. Mark's Episcopal Church in Casper, Wyoming. Today marks the 18th year since his death. When I drove back into the town that afternoon, I stopped at a combination bar and restaurant, which was obviously a major hangout for the college students who lived there and studied just a mile or so up the road. I sat in the bar and thought about the social environment that must have existed, which allowed this to have happened in 1998. The bars that ran up and down the few square blocks of what constituted downtown Laramie in 2009 were open and welcoming, and the people were incredibly friendly. It just didn't square up with me that what I was experiencing as I sat and ate lunch, as people watched sports on an overhead TV. The people that I was seeing that day seemed as if they would have been appalled by such a thing. I think the town had changed since Matthew's death, even if it was just a little bit. I asked my waiter if people talk much nowadays about what had happened. He replied, "Occasionally, but not much. I was only 11 when it happened," he said, "and I'm not from around here." I ate my lunch, got in my car, took a last swing around town, and headed back out to Interstate 80. I couldn't get the picture of the couple in the pickup truck I saw when I first drove into town out of my head. I remembered thinking, "Oh yeah, I can see how this would have gone down in a second." But after spending time in town talking with the people I met, the shopkeepers, a lawyer, and a man at a hardware store who sold me a very unique pocket knife, I just could not square up my initial prejudice with what I experienced by the time I had headed back out of town. I was once that guy in the pickup truck. I hope I had changed just a bit. Please do not hesitate to remind me that the kingdom of God has come near. I suppose that some of it had to do with the passage of time. Some of it was in the normal turnover of people, especially in a college town. And maybe, just maybe, grace had worked its way into the fabric of the lives of the people of Laramie and in our own lives. There is an image that comes to mind when I reflect on Matt on the wooden cross rail fence, the Reverend Royce Brown, rector of St. Mark's, the Casper Church said at Matthew's funeral. "I replace that image," he said, "with that of another man who hung upon a cross. When I concentrate on that man, I can release the bitterness inside." That's a bold statement. It's full of faith and hope and resurrection. But folks, I gotta tell you, I don't know if I could muster those words today, let alone 18 years ago. Nearly 1,000 people packed the two churches in the surrounding area as Matthew's service took place. Matthew's death had a tremendous impact on our society and how we deal with both acceptance and with hate. Matthew's funeral service was the real launch point for the despicable and twisted protests of the defrocked and now deceased Reverend Fred Phelps and his flock at Westboro Baptist Church, whose followers can still be found at funerals and protests everywhere, screaming on street corners and carrying signs that proclaim with unmitigated confidence that God hates fags. Condemnation of an entire group of people in the name of God. My God, I wonder where this will lead. And who else will assume the mantle of hatred and bigotry? For the fields of discord have been sown and the soil is well tilled. The Episcopal Church elected their first openly gay bishop 5 years later, 5 years after Matthew's death. It was a watershed moment for the Episcopal Church. But unfortunately, 13 years later, the church is still divided in some places over the issue of sexuality. Only now, for the most part, the fight is primarily focused, where else? The federal courts. And the issue is not about sex, but about who owns the church properties. The whole issue morphed from a discussion about scripture, sex, and God into a court fight over what else? Money. Silence killed Matthew Shepherd. Bishop Stephen Charleston, then the chaplain of Trinity College in Hartford, Connecticut, said in a chapel sermon, "The silence of Christians who know that our scriptures on homosexuality are few and murky in interpretation and far outweighed by the words of a Savior whose only comment on human relationships was to call us to never judge, but only to love." He goes on to say that the silence of well-meaning, educated people who pretend to have an enlightened view of homosexuality while quietly tolerating the abuse of gays and lesbians in their own communities, the silence of our elected officials who have the authority to make changes but prefer to count votes, the silence of the majority of straight Americans who shift uncomfortably when confronted by the thought that gays and lesbians may be no different than themselves, save for the fact that they are walking targets for bigotry, disrespect, cheap humor, and apparently of murder. This statement by Bishop Charleston was written following Matthew Shepherd's funeral. Unfortunately, it could have been printed in today's newspaper. Even if the targets of our fear and hatred morph into another group that is marginalized but are still children of God. To be sure, much has changed, but alas, too much has stayed the same. We find ourselves battling over inclusion and fighting to establish our own individual righteousness. The national dialogue which consumes our country is full of exclusion, hatred, isolation, and dishonesty by almost everyone who is seeking leadership positions in this country. I have said it before, and it bears repeating again and again. The answers do not lie in our politics, but in our hearts and in our faith. For it is God alone, through the sacrifice of his own Son, Jesus Christ, through which we are given the example of perfection. Writing in his letter to the Romans that we read this morning, Paul reminds us that what was written in former days was written for our instruction, so that by steadfastness and encouragement, we might have hope. Welcoming and living in harmony with one another in accordance with Jesus Christ, so that together with one voice, we may glorify God, the Father of our Lord, Jesus Christ. I can say without hesitation that Matthew Shepherd, although unknown to me, has changed how I live my life, how I see humankind, how I understand other people, and how I understand the presence of God and the love of Jesus Christ in my life and in the lives of others. I pray that I can be constantly reminded that the kingdom of God has come near. Here, now, in Advent, we revisit a new lectionary cycle, year A. For the majority of this liturgical year, we will read primarily from the Gospel of Matthew. It is my hope that during this year, when you hear Deacon Lorna proclaim the gospel by saying, "The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew," and you respond, "Glory to you, Lord Christ," you will hear the gospel with new ears, remembering the story that you have just heard and recalling the life of the disciple Matthew in clearer and more vivid terms. For the disciples of Christ continue to be born and live amongst us, just as Christ lives amongst us today. In the end, I pray that this message might be one of reconciliation, a story of hope that quenches the fires of bigotry, anger, ignorance, and hate. A story of redemption not initiated by ourselves, but born by a refugee woman who said yes to God and gave birth to a son, Jesus. Born extramuros, mind you, who himself is the initiator of sacrifice, forgiveness, and reconciliation, and is the author of our salvation. The Christ with whom we gather and worship this season and this morning. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. For the kingdom of God has come near, but it's not here yet.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. Come again to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
I invite you to join in today's prayers of the people, which is found on page 3 in your bulletin. As we anticipate the fullness of the presence of Christ, we join with the church throughout the world praying for all who are in need. For the church throughout the world, for all inspired and led by the Holy Spirit, and for all who proclaim the wondrous deeds of God, that all divisions and disagreements cease. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For the earth and its creatures, for animals of every size, for plants that provide shade and nourishment, that we see God's goodness revealed in every living thing. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For the nations and those in authority, for police officers and firefighters, for social workers and attorneys, that God grant them wisdom to work for peace and justice.
Let us
pray. Have mercy, O God.
Have mercy, O God.
For the poor, the meek, the unwelcomed, those suffering from malaria and HIV/AIDS, the sick and the bereaved, that they experience Christ embodied in healthcare workers and caregivers. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For those traveling and those absent from this gathering, for those serving in the military, for those preparing for baptism, and for our congregation, that in all we do, we praise and glorify God. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
In thanksgiving for the faithful departed who have died in Christ, remembering especially John of Damascus, Clement of Alexandria, Nicholas of Myra, Juan Diego, Karl Barth, and Thomas Merton, that they show us the way of hope through the incarnate word. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
At this time, let us offer to Christ all that's on our hearts, because he hears our every prayer.
Pray for those who are on active duty, who have been deployed.
We remember the people of Oakland, California. Pray for the peaceful repose of those who died in the fire.
Victims of fire in Tennessee.
We lift up to Christ all those in our congregation who have asked our prayers, remembering especially those who are ill, those who are battling cancer, those who are not able to be with us today.
Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, those spoken aloud and those known only to you, and grant us peace through Jesus Christ, our coming Savior.
Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart.
We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves.
We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name.
Amen. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Good morning and welcome all. The big thing happening this week, of course, is on Wednesday evening, and it will be the day the trees arrive, the trees and the wreaths. So if you've ordered a tree or a wreath, you can pick them up Wednesday evening. Now, the members of the Spanish-speaking congregation and the ESOL class will be decorating a tree for the parish hall and having a potluck, and all are invited to join in the potluck if you would like to come along for that. So that's the big hoop-de-doo of the week. Now, if before the hoop-de-doo you want an evening of some calm and meditation and prayer, it's ready to go.
Good morning. On Tuesday's evenings at 7 o'clock, the Inamkara Fellowship in the Nave will have a Celtic service. Last about a half hour. Prayer, a little bit of quiet, some music. And we would love for anyone that would want to come share in some quiet time during Advent with us. So that's Tuesdays at 7 o'clock, and it'll be for the next three Tuesdays. You missed mine last week. It was great.
Okay, thank you. All right. Are there any birthdays, wedding anniversaries, or travelers for blessings?
Yeah, that was the first one she did.
Birthday? Oh my goodness, birthday. Lots of birthdays. Okay, travelers, over there. Birthday? Oh my goodness, lots of birthdays. Oh God, our times are in your hand. Look with favor, we pray, on these your servants as they begin another year. Grant that they may grow in wisdom and grace, and strengthen their trust in your goodness all the days of their lives, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Happy birthday.
Thank you.
Oops. Oh God, our Heavenly Father, whose glory fills the whole creation, whose presence we find wherever we go, preserve those who travel, surround them with your loving care, protect them from every danger, and bring them in safety to their journey's end. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. 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 And amen. Traveling mercies. Mm-hmm. Father Mark.
Brotherhood of St. Andrew will come up, but before we do that, I need to ask your indulgence. I need some help with something. I need to find out the will of the people. We have an interesting calendar issue that is going to come up. Christmas Eve will be Saturday night. The 24th will be Saturday night, and we will have services, Christmas Eve services at 5, 7, and 10 p.m. like we always do. Now, the challenge comes on Christmas Day, which is Sunday. So you leave here at midnight, 12:30, and then you roll back in at 8 o'clock. Is anybody on for that? There were a couple of people from 8 o'clock who said, yeah. Well, no. So I need to get some feedback. Is it okay if we combine the three Sunday services into one service, which will be the 10:30 service? Now, the challenge is going to be, and I'm not going to press it this Sunday, but I will later, is that it's a Sunday, and you have pledges that you need to keep up, and we're going to need to talk about those, because we can't take that hit. Now, the challenge will come up again, this might even be more fun, on New Year's. New Year's Day, after everyone parties and gets to bed at 8 o'clock at night, New Year's Day is Sunday. Do we just want to have one service at 10:30? Okay. There were people at 8 o'clock again who said, no. Okay. All right. So spread the word, please. Make sure everyone understands that on those two Sundays, we'll have combined service at 10:30. It could be a bond. It was very good. It would be a bond where everyone would get a chance to meet someone. I'm sure you will all say, welcome to St. Mary Magdalene. And they'll say, I've been coming to this church for 25 years. Well, I don't ever see you. Well, I come to the 8 o'clock service. So that's what will happen. So, yeah, and you're, oh, yeah, that'll be the biggest thing. You will be sitting in someone's pew. And they're going to come in, and I'm going to sit up here and watch the 8 o'clockers go get. So that's what will happen. So we'll have fun. We'll get to know each other a little bit better. Christmas Day and Sunday and New Year's Day. Now, one other thing, this sermon that I just preached, I printed it out. So it is in the back of the church. If you'd like to take a copy with you, you can do that. It's in the back of the church. It's probably not there yet. Lucy is going in to get it. We'll lay it out. It'll be there available for you. Now, we have the opportunity to have the rededication of the members of the Brotherhood of St. Andrew. And at this time, we would like to go ahead and invite them to come up. All the members, all the men in the congregation are welcome to become members of the Brotherhood of St. Andrew. If you are not a member now and would like to join, just come on up. It's that easy. It's about getting the men involved in the church, which they already are to a large degree. So I would invite the men to come forward. And we'll have the rededication ceremony for the Brotherhood of St. Andrew. And I think we have some traveling music. I did not know the organ would do that. You have coaxed a new sound out of that organ. I am. So I will too then. So to address all of you, the Brotherhood of St. Andrew is a ministry to men and youth dedicated to the spread of Christ's kingdom by means of prayer, study, and service. The discipline of prayer is to pray daily for the spread of Christ's kingdom, especially among men and youth, and for God's blessing on the labors of the Brotherhood. The discipline of study is to study the Holy Scriptures regularly and the teachings of the church to attain a better understanding of how to follow Christ and bring others into Christ's kingdom. The discipline of service is to make continuous efforts week by week to bring others nearer to Christ through His church. I address all of you. Do you desire to continue your membership in the Brotherhood of St. Andrew?
I do.
Do you reaffirm your commitment to service in the name of Jesus Christ?
I do.
Will you, with God's help, work faithfully to fulfill the objectives and disciplines of the Brotherhood?
I will, with God's help.
Almighty God, who has given you the will to do these things, strengthen you so that he may finish the work which he has begun in you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, look with favor upon these persons who have now reaffirmed their commitment to follow Christ and to serve his name in the Brotherhood of St. Andrew. Give them courage, patience, and vision, and strengthen them in their Christian vocation of witness to the world and of service to others through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you. Would anyone like to talk at all? Where'd the mic go? No? You've already said it all. Okay. All right. Thank you very much. We appreciate everything that you do in this church. Thank you. Can I sit down? The Brotherhood will be hosting coffee hour right after this service, so please join with them so that we can share in some fellowship after the service right outside. We'll have coffee hour. I think that's it. Mm-hmm. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God.
And a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, because you sent your beloved Son to redeem us from sin and death and to make us heirs in him of everlasting life, that when he shall come again in power and great triumph to judge the world, he may without shame or fear rejoice to behold his appearing. Therefore, we praise you,
joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your words spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the Word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where, with Mary, the mother of our Lord, Mary Magdalene, John the Baptizer, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Alleluia. Gifts of God for the people of God. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. Would the Eucharistic visitor please come forward?
Let us send her out together as she goes to visit those who are ill. In the name of this congregation, we send you forth bearing these holy gifts, that those to whom you go may share with us in the communion of Christ's body and blood. We who are many are one body, because we all share one bread, one cup.
May Christ, the Son of Righteousness, shine upon you and scatter the darkness from before your path. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you this day and always. Amen.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.